to please Allah, a chance to gain reward, I will spend on you, he says, on who spend in good cause.
Good deeds are opportunities, sparkling bright and true, raising you in the sight of Allah and adorning Al-Jannah for you. So rush to earn His reward, don't forget the oppressed, and when you go to sleep at night.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another episode of A Time to Please Allah. Thursday nights, alhamdulillah, from Dubai. And if you're just joining us, make sure you check our Facebook page, A Time to Please Allah, and our YouTube page, where you can see previously recorded videos. If you missed any of the videos, alhamdulillah, we have a variety. And now we have over 1 year of episodes, alhamdulillah, and a lot of interesting topics, from youth to culture to music to you name it. I think we've covered a lot of things, including relationships between husbands and wives and dating and all kinds of things from different angles, alhamdulillah. And today, of course, we're bringing to you another episode, alhamdulillah, that is very interesting and very important. And it's a continuation of a previous episode, and it is on the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And joining me in the studio are my dear brothers, alhamdulillah, Brother Asif, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
And Brother Ayaz, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
طيب, so let us jump into it, inshallah. This is a very interesting topic, and it is something that is actually tied to our aqidah. And that is it's the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I want to go back, obviously, to a few points from last episode. And there are some things that's kind of spurred this, this discussion. You know, some incidents with a lot of pressure today from groups to work together more. And you can say, yes, you understand, but you disagree. You know, yes, there's a lot of pressure. We understand it. And yes, the Muslims have to unite, but the question is, unite upon what? When no doubt, and that's the funny thing, is that critics will say, you guys don't want to unite. You guys don't like unity. You just want to do your own thing. You criticize. It's not about that. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. This is, we believe in this, but unite upon what? That is the question.
Right. So there's obviously the famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the best action is to love for the sake of Allah and hate for the sake of Allah. So when we come together, when we unite, when we love a person, it has to be for the sake of Allah. And I think this should form the basis, and this is why it's going back to our aqidah. This has to form the basis of how we conduct our relationships with our fellow human beings.
I mean, something so beautiful, they say love, right? I mean, people are shy to talk about love these days, right? They're like, love, It's like, no, we have to be like men with beards, cannot talk about love, But love is something amazing, And the most, amazing love that a person can have is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to love someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Allahu Akbar.
And the Prophet said, what did he say? He said that if you love someone for the sake of Allah, you should tell them, right? You should tell them, subhanAllah. And also, one of the groups of people that will be shaded under the shade of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment, there's no shade except that, will be people who love each other for sake, who meet for a sake of Allah and depart for a sake of Allah. Such an emotional, beautiful thing, subhanAllah. Because we're always, I'm really tired, sometimes, that we're being criticized. You guys, no emotions, no feelings. It's not there. It's everything is haram, halal, and it's not like that. It's not like that. People are not listening. They're not hearing. They're not hearing.
It's true indeed that what the Prophet said, for verily unity will come from love, and the love of your Muslim brother, and this goes back to the iman as well. And the Prophet Muhammad said, if ever in a heart, three things are there, that person will have the sweetness of Iman.
Subhanallah.
It's called halawatul Iman.
Halawatul Iman. No.
And one of them is to love your Muslim brother solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
No.
And that's one of the ways of being united.
No.
This is what you said, Jazakallah khair. And of course, like how you said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the day of judgment, we say, we proclaim, أَيْنَ الْمُتَحَابُونَ لِجَلَالِي الْيَوْمَ أَظِلْهُمْ فِي ظِلِّي يَوْمَ نَظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلِّي.
Subhanallah.
Where are those who used to love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because this goes to the ayah, what you said in the beginning, وَاَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. In order for you to get to become together, it's unity, and unity comes from love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
No.
And this is even like how you said, if you're a Muslim, you love your Muslim brother, let him know. Go and tell him that you love him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
No.
And the true love, you will see that, like how the Sahaba, how they used to love the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we will try to compare that to our love to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In no doubt, we cannot compare our love to the love, our love of the Prophet sent to the Sahaba, because they used to see the Sahaba. Yeah. So let's see our contrast. Let's see how can we compare that, and how the Sahaba used to love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how they used to give their life for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Something, you know, going back to the ayah, وَاتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ الْجَمِيعِ وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. يعني حَبْلُ اللَّهِ الْجَمِيعِ, يعني all of you hold on to rope of Allah. The rope of Allah, as the scholar says, like the Quran and the Sunnah, right? And this is going back to my initial statement that what spurred the discussion about the Sahaba is that people are calling towards unity sometimes, right? But yani, there are some people who are not criticizing Sahaba, yani they're insulting Sahaba, they are disrespecting them, they are even the fact of degrading their level, yani, just putting it like you know, a level before, saying, well, you know, they're just like, you know, whatever. Yeah, of course, they're human beings. They're people. But honey, these are people, as the scholars say, I believe it was Ibn Abbas, and he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he knew exactly who to reveal the Quran to, right?
Allah,
the Prophet. And then he also knew who the people around him will be, yani, that will be his companions. Yani, you know, Allah, yani, didn't just, yani, you know, just happen. Let me just send, you know, subhanAllah. And yani, these people are not just anyone. Yeah.
No.
So people who insult them, people who take their, you know, their character and their in question, right? I mean, they're actually trying to, in the end, attack Islam, because the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum ajma'in, were the ones who carried Islam, you know. And if their character is in doubt, then Islam is in doubt, right? These are the people who recorded the Quran by writing and by memorizing.
Allahu Akbar.
These are the people who carry the fiqh and the aqidah and everything. If Abu Huraira is in doubt, as the people are trying to attack him, oh, why are you narrating? Then Islam is in doubt. A big chunk of the corpus of hadith is in doubt. If Aisha is in doubt, a big chunk of how the Prophet ﷺ used to be in the house, his personal things, and how he used to deal, what he used to do, wash this, is in doubt.
It is clear cut. People who speak bad about the Sahaba, first of all, it's really sad. And clear cut, some of the ulama say it is kufr.
So
because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, radiyallahu anhum wa rabu an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with the Sahaba. The ulama says, al-ridha a'la maratib al-hub.
Again.
Al-ridha, being pleased, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the Quran, he's pleased with them. And now you come and then you start cursing them. You start saying bad things about them, and it's in the Quran. So some of the ulama says this is kufr.
Allah.
You come and say bad things about the Sahaba, this is kufr. So inshallah, bi-idhnillah ta'ala, if we have time, bi-idhnillah, we speak how the Sahaba, the same Sahaba that you find people are cursing, how they used to be under the service of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from hadith, authentic hadith, Bukhari, Muslim, and then we'll see if you can open your mouth and say anything bad about those Sahaba.
طيب, why are the Sahaba not like us, brother Asif? Yani, why can we say that, you know, yani, they're humans, we're humans, of course, we're all humans, yani, but you know, some people, yani, they won't necessarily criticize them or curse them, but they'll like, you know, they won't give them their haqq in terms of who they were.
Right. So, I mean, the biggest thing, of course, and you kind of alluded to this, is the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose this generation to be surrounding the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to be the conduits through which the religion was going to be conveyed.
No.
So, of course, the choice of Allah is the best of choices, right? These people were chosen for very specific reasons, and there was different sahaba who played different roles. Some were fighters, some were writers, some were scholars, some were, and they played all the different roles, right? And they conveyed the message and the whatever parts of the message that we know Zayd ibn Thabit was known for the Quran, right? We know Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was the scholar of the Sahaba. We had the leadership, the examples of leadership in Abu Bakr and Umar and the other Umara. So we had all of these examples. These people learned at the feet of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? They learned directly from the source. I believe it was Salama, she said when the Prophet ﷺ passed away and she was sad, she said, I am sad because the connection to the heavens has been cut. So this is why she was sad.
Allah.
Right? So they were taking directly from one of the sources of legislation we have in this deen. We have to understand how valuable this is, how important this is. They were learning directly from the Prophet ﷺ. So this way we know in part of our aqidah is to believe that their aqidah was correct, was valid, was authentic, have any doubts about this.
It's right. Like, you know, as people say today, like if you have studied with a certain scholar, right, your level increases. Oh, this scholar studied, this brother studied with Sheikh bin Baz or with Sheikh bin Thaymin, or he studied, you know, in such and such institute or here, right? Like, or already there's an awe, right? People are like, oh, there's respect, right? I mean, what about studying with the one who received revelation from Jibreel alayhi salam, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Like, what is their level? You talked, Brother Yad, about the love that the Sahabas had for the Prophet. Let us reverse a bit. Why would they, these Sahabas, love the Prophet so much? I was listening recently to a lecture. Shaykh Muhammad Arif was saying, he was comparing a little bit of, you know, he was saying like the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu, and why they're ready to lay down their life for the Prophet. Is it because he pushed them? Is it because he made some law that if you ever, you know, say something against me, you know, you're going to get punished? Or what was it that these Sahabas were ready, you know, to do anything for the Prophet? You know, these are people with brains, they can see, they can observe. If there's any issue, you know, they'll say, I don't agree or anything. But we find that these people are like, almost exaggerating, you know, in their in rushing and racing to serve him, to do things, to protect him, all these things. It's not normal, you know. If we're at work, right, we might like our boss, we might like what we're doing, because we're always like, okay, you know, there's someone's watching me, I have to be careful, I have to do my job, blah, blah, blah. You're doing it, you know, alhamdulillah, you want to do it, but it's not like, why, the Sahabas were like that?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We know very well the definition of a Sahaba. مَنْ لَقِيَ النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَآمَنَ بِهُ مَاتَ عَلَى
ذَلِكَ.
So those people, the definition is the one who met the Prophet Muhammad and believed in his message and died upon that message. Free.
Very important.
Who met him, believed in that message and died upon that. Because there were many people who met him and believed and then
they went back.
So those people, they were living among the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They saw the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the way he was tortured. They saw the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the way it was difficult for him to hold the revelation from Jibreel. They saw the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam how he was being expelled from his hometown Mecca, and they would see the mu'jiza, the shaq al-qamar. They would see how the Prophet split the moon, the mu'jiza were right in front of them. And in the beginning, how we said, al-ikhlas.
Yes, that's sincere.
The ikhlas and our ikhlas are not the same. For them, the amal they would do, the only goal was al-jannah. They would do something because it was sunnah. Nowadays, we don't do things because it is sunnah. We don't do the sunnah, مثلا, before Fajr or after Maghrib. Our brother, it's sunnah. But for them and the Salaf al-Salih, the Tabi'in, what they would do, wajib is another level, is another rank. But when it comes to Sunnah, they would emphasize so much like if it was wajib.
Like it was wajib.
So that's the difference between us and them. Nowadays, no, brother, that's only Sunnah. You don't need to do it.
Mm.
Why? Because if you do it, you're going to get rewarded. If you don't do it, you won't be punished. But for them, the definition was different. We're going to do it because we want to be with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The worries of the Sahaba. One day, one of the Ansari, he was sad.
Mm.
The Prophet Muhammad said, look at the concern of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why are you so concerned? Your face are not the same as yesterday. He said, Ya Rasulullah, in the morning we see you, in the evening we see you, today we are with you, but tomorrow you passed away,
no.
You're going to be among the Prophet. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he kept quiet. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَلِي الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٍ يُوحَىٰ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to speak, wait for the revelation to come.
No.
And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got the revelation. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ. And then he told the Sahaba that one ayah has been revealed regarding that situation. Those people who obey Allah and obey the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they will be raised among the prophets. It's not only me who's going to be among the prophets. People who believe in obey Allah and obey the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they will be raised among the prophets and the shuhada and the as-siddiqin. So this shows how the concern they used to have, how they used to rush. If ever we were to look at the love of the Sahaba towards the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even Urwa, when he went to check on the Muslim in the Am al-Fatih, he saw the Sahaba next to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam while he was making wudu. He studied the Sahaba. He went back to the Quraysh. He said, for verily I went to the king of Caesars, king of Khusro and Najashi. I did not see their people respect Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they knew that victory will come through this. Victory will come through the unity they had. He was like, whenever Rasulullah would speak, they would listen. Whenever he would make wudu, they would keep the water. This is the way, because they used to know the blessing of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now we compare that to us.
The Sahaba knew, and we should know obviously, that the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was success for them. I mean, you can almost look at it in a very selfish way. If they followed and they took everything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was giving to them, they would succeed. Ultimately, we're doing this all for ourselves. We are trying to get to Jannah. The way to get to Jannah, Imam Malik had the famous statement that the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is like Safinat al-Nuh. It is the ship of Nuh alayhi salam. Whoever gets on it, he is saved. And whoever, you know, declines, whoever rejects, he is drowned. He will be destroyed.
Allahu Akbar.
So this, they knew that this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is bringing to them is salvation. Salvation from the hellfire and entry into Jannah. So how much should you love the person who brings you the most valuable thing you can't even imagine.
No.
You can't even imagine. No. So how much would you, what can you bring me? Right? You can invite me over to your house, you can put some nice food out and give me some, you know, qahwa and shai and this and that. What else can you give me? Maybe you can help me out if I'm stuck on the road, or, you know, how much can you really give me? And then you think about, and then this is that famous hadith of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I love you more than anything except my own self. Right? He says, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, not yet. Right? He says, you will not truly believe, you will not have the completeness of Iman until you love me more than anything else, including yourself. Then Umar ibn Khattab, and people have a misconception about the hadith, he thought about it instantaneously. And just a very short time, and he came back and said, now I love you more than anything, even my own self. Because one of the scholars talked about this hadith, he thought about what can I do for myself? And what can the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his sunnah do for me? What he can do, what he is offering me, is far greater than anything I can even do for myself, much less anyone else.
Yeah.
So of course I should love him more than anything, including my parents, including my father, my mother, myself, anything else.
No.
Because of what he's bringing to me.
there's something amazing here. I mean, what you're saying is just amazing, mind-blowing. Yani, that obviously these people understood the benefit that the Prophet offered. But there's also this, yani, when you read the ahadith, yani, like they were like sincerely, like, you know, if I can say the word, in love with them. Yani,
Allah,
you know?
Allah.
Like they truly love them.
Allah.
And I think this is more like, it's a miracle of the Prophet. What kind of person must he have been that people were so, you know, attracted to him, and even including his enemies, right? So you have, you know, the Sahaba, and they're going for battle, right? And he's playing like a little trick on the Prophet, right? So they're, you know, the Prophet is to kind of check the line, and he like with the stick, you know, just like put him, you know, on the line, right? And then the Sahaba said, you've hurt me, Rasulullah, like you've caused me pain, right?
So what?
So the Prophet said, okay, khud, yani, take the stick, yani,
qisas.
Take qisas, you know, like take retribution. The Prophet said, no, the Sahaba said, no, like, you know, you cause pain, like, oh my, you have to like lift your shirt up, right? So he lifted it up. So he kissed it, and he kissed, you know. And the Prophet said, what are you doing? He's like, you know, we're going into battle, you know.
Allah,
you know?
Allah.
If this is the last thing I want to do. So when you think about that, now again, what was it? Yes, of course, they knew that they had a lot of benefit from the Prophet. They knew that they were going to, you know, al-mar'u ma'a man ahabb, as the Prophet said to Anas ibn Malik, right?
Allah,
the hadith, the beautiful, that the person will be with whom he loves, and
Allah
Akbar. Again, love, right? So these Sahabas understood that, like, you know, because love, yani, you cannot force love, you know. Yes, there's, you know, we understand there's benefits, this makes sense, but love is not something you can force. And that's why, as one of the scholars was saying, you know, it's like these people were, they're not abid, yani, they were not, you know, ghanam, yani, they're not like sheep, yani, you know. Like stick them and tell them, come here, if you don't do this, I'm going to beat you, I'm going to go to jail, or, you know, this or this. And they sincerely, he took them through tarbiyah. Mm. They studied his feet. They observed his life.
Yes.
His lifestyle. And how kind, you know, I mean, they loved him. Genuine love.
Too
right?
Much.
Which is like, if we look at ourselves, there's some people who like us. And many people who don't, and, you know. But the Prophet is like, yani, almost everyone liked him, and even the people who didn't like him, they still, yani, they couldn't
respected
help
him.
They, yeah, they couldn't
they
help
trusted
him.
Yeah.
You know, they would leave their valuables with him. They would call him, you know, Al-Amin,
Sadiq
Al-Amin, yani, they would do all kinds, you know, you're, yani, the best of us, yani, you know. But they had issues not with him, they had issues with what he was calling to.
Yes.
You know? That's what they had issues. But him as a person, they said, you are the best of us, yani, right? There's no such thing, we didn't meet anyone like, you know, we met you. And you cannot fake this, you know.
Allahu Akbar. This is, especially if you're telling me the way that we used to be in love with the Prophet Muhammad Sallam, the way they used to defend the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and the narration you mentioned in the beginning, this happened right on the battlefield with Sawad. And subhanAllah, let me tell you, the Sahaba, they used to be happy when the Prophet Muhammad was happy. They would feel it.
Yeah.
The Sahaba will be sad when the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will be sad.
Allah.
And they had the feeling before the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam passed away. One day, just a couple of days before the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam passed away, he went on the minbar, speaking to the Sahaba. Whenever the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would speak to the Sahaba, out of respect, they would look down like if pigeons are sitting on their head,
Allah.
Attentive. And then he said, anyone who has to retaliate from me, please do so before it's too late. Who would want to retaliate from the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam?
No.
Who would want to? They all sat down. Someone from the middle of the masjid got up. He came, while he was coming in front, he said, Ana ya Rasulullah.
Allah.
As long as you ask for retaliation, I will retaliate today.
Allah.
All the Sahaba were crying when they heard this.
They're like,
the
what?
Tears. Who is daring to retaliate to the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Ali ibn Abi Talib said, Ya Rasulullah, let him retaliate on me, not on you.
Allah.
Al Abbas said, Ya Rasulullah, let him retaliate on me, not on you.
Allah.
The Prophet said, La. I did something bad to him, let him come retaliate. When he was coming, Rasulullah saw him say, Ukasha bin Muhsin.
Oh, okay.
Ukasha bin Muhsin. For verily, whoso فوالذي نفسي بيدي for verily I made dua for you in order for you to enter Jannah بلا حساب ولا عذاب.
Allah.
I made dua for you, Ya Ukasha, to enter Jannah without judgment and without punishment, and you want retaliation, tell me.
Allah.
He said, Ya Rasulullah, you remember when you poked me? You remember when you poked me?
Allah.
While making the sufuf of the ma'raka.
Allah,
na'am. He said, come.
Allah.
He went in the minbar, on the minbar in front of everyone. He got the stick. He said, Ya Rasulullah, you poked me somewhere.
Allah.
The Prophet Muhammad lift up his thawb.
Yes.
And then the Sahaba was looking, was watching what Ukasha gonna do.
Oh, man.
He moved the stick first time, second time, and third time. He left the stick over there. He held the Prophet Muhammad and kissed the Prophet Muhammad. Said, Ya Ukasha, lima hada, Ya Ukasha, what are you doing? He started crying.
Allah.
He said, Ya Rasulullah, I would love that the last skin to touch you on the fifth of the earth before you leave will be my skin, Ya Rasulullah. Same like Sawad said on the Ma'araka, say, Ya Rasulullah, death is here. And I would love that before I die, I touch your body, Ya Rasulullah.
Allah. SubhanAllah. These people are definitely, their sincerity and their love is just amazing. We're going to have to take a short break, inshallah, and we'll continue with the Sahaba, Rasulullah. A very emotional topic, subhanAllah, and rightly so, subhanAllah. And it is about love and about compassion. And inshallah, we'll take a few minutes and we'll come back on Huda TV. Inshallah, time to please Allah.
A chance to gain reward, I will spend on you, he says.
O Allah, to you belongs all praise. You are the light of the heavens and the earth and all that is within them.
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا عَنْهَا لَا تُفَتَّحُ لَهُمْ أَبْوَابُ السَّمَاءِ وَلَا يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةِ حتى يلج الجمل في سم الخياط.
Sister Amina is asking, is it true that you can see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the dream? The answer is yes. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in an authentic hadith, he said, من رآني في المنام فقد رآني فإن الشيطان لا يتمثل بي.
After the soul departs the body, it makes its journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it was righteous soul, it will be given permission to enter into the heavens. But if the soul was wicked, no.
إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ.
Whosoever associates someone in worship with Allah, even if it is me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make Jannah haram and lawful for that person.
TV commercials motivate viewers into immediate action and to sway consumer loyalty from one brand or service to the other. That's why we're here for you, to help you sell your products and services by using creative ideas that bring life into your own TV commercial. Advertise your business and branded products and services on Huda TV. We will offer you fast-paced and energetic 30-second affordable TV spots. Advertise on Huda TV. Acquire fresh customers and stay within your budget. For more info or to receive a quote, please send your inquiries to advert at Huda TV. Huda TV.
It's time to please Allah. A chance to gain reward. I will spend on you, he says.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. It's time to please Allah. If you're just joining us, we are talking about the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, very emotional topic, because we're speaking about their love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Their, you know, and by this we're trying to show our viewers and people at large their status in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the state that it should have in the sight of the ummah, and the respect that people should have for them. Just before the break, we're talking about two incidences, and that is the two sahabas who were, you know, they wanted the last thing to do is to hug the Prophet, to feel his skin,
Allah,
that barakah, you know, yes, the real,
Allah. Now, thanks. Even if you want to look at Bilal ibn Rabah, Bilal ibn Rabah, wherever the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go, he would go with him. And even Bilal ibn Rabah said something before the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He passed by the Hujra of Aisha radiallahu anha, and he noticed the way Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was suffering. When he saw that, he was like, how sad it is, how I wish I would die before seeing the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that state. Bilal ibn Rabah, we know he was the muezzin. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, he was still giving the adhan. And it is said that whenever Bilal ibn Rabah would say Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah,
Allahu Akbar,
during the lifetime of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, something Rasulullah would come out.
Subhanallah.
He said after the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to say Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, and he started to choke.
Subhanallah.
And to say that he fainted. Allahu Akbar. He kept on doing that, and he went to Abu Bakr. After the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Ya Abu Bakr, I cannot stay in Medina without the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya Abu Bakr, if you freed me for your sake, I will stay here." Because Abu Bakr, he was like, "Ya Bilal, don't leave Medina. We need you here." He said, "Ya Abu Bakr, listen, if ever you freed me for your sake, I will stay here. But if you freed me for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let me go." He could not stay in Medina without the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He went. He stayed for some time outside Medina. And then he came back. When he came back, after a long while, the grandson of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it was Hassan and Hussein, tell me, Ya Bilal, go and give the adhan. Go and give the adhan. He went to the same place he used to give the adhan. When he was giving the adhan, it was said that Medina, Yathrib, was erupted in tears. It was said that even the ladies didn't know what to do. You know how ladies are. Because when they heard Bilal radiallahu anhu, who did they think of? They were not crying because of Bilal. They were crying because of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because we used to listen to this voice
when he was around.
When Bilal, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was here. Again, he still couldn't. He tried to stay here in Medina. He couldn't. And then later on, when at the time of Umar, when they opened Al-Quds, Bilal was present. The Sahaba, who was young at the time of Medina. And now, those Sahaba, whose beard has become white, they told Umar, Ya Umar, ask Bilal to go and give the adhan.
Allah.
When he started giving the adhan, all the Sahaba, the beard was filled up with tears. The same beard that used to fill up with tears when it was black, now it's white. It's still, why? Because they're thinking of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is Bilal ibn Rabah. The love he used to have. And when before he passed away, his wife was saying, how sad. He said, don't say how sad, because he's going to meet the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he was among the people who the Prophet Muhammad said, Ya Bilal, what do you do? That I heard your footstep in front of me in Jannah.
Allah Akbar.
So he was among the people who was promised Jannah.
Allah Akbar.
Allahu Akbar. Even the Sahaba, they could not see the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They couldn't see his face in awe. They couldn't see his face in any kind of sad situation. They could never ever see. Even one of the Sahaba called Jabir ibn Abdullah, you know, after 3 days while they were digging the trench, Jabir saw how the Prophet Muhammad was suffering from hunger. He said, Ya Rasulullah, give me permission to go back home after 3 days of digging the trench. Because he couldn't hold seeing the Prophet Muhammad hungry. Yeah. He went home, he told his wife, what do you have? I want to invite the Prophet Muhammad. He said, we have a small goat and some wheat barley. He told his wife, try to get it ready. But she said, listen, this won't be enough. Get it ready, we're going to bring the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jabir ibn Abdullah, before he left, the wife said, listen, don't make me feel shy for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't bring too many people, this is only for one or two people. Jabir ibn Abdullah went to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He whispered, Ya Rasulullah, a'zimuka, today I want you to come and have meal in my house. Take you and two sahaba and come. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he knew his barakah.
Allah.
He called to a city of around 1,000, called all of them. Today,
Allah.
We have azima at Jabir ibn Abdullah. Jabir ibn Abdullah said, he said in the hadith, that day I never felt shy in my whole life apart from that day.
Allah.
I didn't know what to do. We went in. Now guess what? Your wife waiting at home, she told you. She told you bring only one or two, you bring 1,000. And then quick Rasulullah said, go and tell your wife, do not start cooking until I come there. And then Rasulullah went there. He put the barakah of his spit. He passed it on the food over there. And then it said that it fed the whole 1,000 people.
Allah.
This Jabir ibn Abdullah, he could not see the hunger on the feet of the Prophet Muhammad. He rushed back home for that reason. Otherwise, he could have carried on digging the trench. They could not see the Prophet Muhammad in such situation. Allahu Akbar.
Allah. One of the beautiful things that you mentioned, the story of Jabir ibn Abdullah, Bilal ibn Abi Rabah, and the Sahabas. One of the things that is important to highlight that these people were an exemplary society. Like today we are suffering, our ummah is suffering from racism, from discrimination, right? We're having issues, agreeing with each other. You have the Pakistani brand of Islam, you got the Turkish brand of Islam, you got the Arab brand of Islam, you got the all kinds of things, people are coming with brands of Islam. And it's causing issues. And within a city, sometimes you have one masjid from this nationality, one masjid from the other nationality. And we cannot get, it's like, we're so different. Let's start our own masjid. The Sahaba were different.
Allah.
They're not, Bilal is from this Habashi, and Salman is Farsi, and some of the Sahabas were from, Suhaib al-Rumi, and other Sahabas were not, not everyone was Quraysh, But they had this amazing, and they had some issues, of course, no doubt, who doesn't? But they had an amazing society, a perfect society, if you could, we're the closest to perfect, serving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being with the Prophet and what were the things that made them successful, even though they're from different cultures, different social status, different knowledge, different everything, different capabilities, as we are today, and we're still, we cannot agree with each other. But what made that?
You talked about this brotherhood, and we the very first thing we started with was the basis of brotherhood, what it has to be. So you don't have to look any further than the Sunnah. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with his Sahaba, with the Muhajirin, when they migrated to Medina, right? Those connections that he made, he paired up one Muhajir with one Ansari, right? Yeah. These are people. It's something incredible when you think about it. Okay.
Yeah, good. Okay, good. I just want to. Something came to my mind when he said that he paired one Muhajir with Ansari. I tried. We had a certain program. Okay, I'm not going to say where, how, when, and it was based on the same concept. We tried to pair one new Muslim with a family, existing family Muslim, right? A very strong community. A lot of very, people were coming praying Fajr in the Masjid. That Masjid is packed at Fajr. Durus, proper things, everything is there. Beards, Sunnah, people arguing, make sure that you're in the Sunnah, this and that. But when it came to that, when we made that program, people signed up. Not even one worked out. And correct me if I'm wrong, it was the Ansar was supposed to accommodate the Muhajirin. Yes. Okay? And that's how we set it up. We said, well, you know, the new Muslims are the ones who made hijrah to the deen, yani.
Right.
And you guys are the Ansar, the helpers, because you've already been in the deen. It's your culture, it's your family, you're established, you have people, you know, you already, you know. But subhanAllah, it was not working.
Unfortunately, in this day and age, people have compartmentalized this deen into a religion.
Hmm.
Our deen, Islam, is not a religion, right?
Okay.
It's not just when you're in the masjid.
Yes.
It's not just when it's Ramadan. It's not just when you're making Umrah and Hajj. It is a holistic system of life.
No.
It governs how we relate to each other. And people are missing this. This is a simple fact. Unfortunately, many, many people in our ummah are missing this fact. How I deal with you, how I deal with a non-Muslim, how I deal with a new Muslim, how I deal with an old Muslim. I mean, all of this stuff is covered, is governed, is legislated in our deen. And the problem is people don't realize, and like I said, they've compartmentalized. They've just taken the rituals of the deen. They'll come to the fajr, they'll come to the masjid, they'll read Quran, they'll make the dhikr, they'll go to the dars. But when it comes to actually putting that, implementing all of that tarbiyah, if you will, putting that into effect in your real everyday life, this whole concept of the guy who's in the masjid and this and that, and he's on the front row and everything, and then if you see him when he's working in his office job, it's night and day. It's like a completely different person, right? And we have this thing. That, the translation from the masjid to your everyday life, right? There's that disconnect there, unfortunately, right? We have ritualized the religion. We've compartmentalized the religion just to a certain time in a certain place. And it doesn't have that proper effect that it should for the whole life. And once again, this is where we have to look to the Sahaba.
That is very, very deep, mashallah, subhanAllah. I mean, that's so true. We're going to take another short break, inshallah, and we're going to come back with the last piece, inshallah. Speaking about the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, I mean, you know, we're slowly starting to put the pieces together as to why that society was the society Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose as an exemplary society, and almost you can say a utopic society when it comes from the Islamic perspective, yani the brotherhood. And subhanAllah, I mean, this is something that everyone has to understand, know. And when someone does understand that, there's no doubt that they will not even dare, yani, to touch the honor of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. We'll take a short break, inshallah. We'll be back on Huda TV, a light in every home.
To please Allah, a chance to gain reward, I will spend on you, he says.
Ya dhal jalal wal ikram, ya hayyu ya qayyum, la ilaha illa anta subhanaka inna kunna minal zalimeen. اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها معادنا واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. أفرأيتم ما تحرثون أأنتم تزرعونه أم نحن الزارعون.
Sister Reem, this ayah again, and I want you to notice that there is إخفاء. The noon of antum is followed by the letter ta, one of the 15 letters which produces ikhfa. So you will say antum, أأنتم. You will tend to hide and conceal the noon and replace it with the غنّة. Two counts.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أفرأيتم ما تحرثون.
Then do you not give thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And we learn how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, Alhamdulillah alladhi ja'alahu adban furatan walam yaj'alhu milhan hujajan. So this is one meaning concerning fala uqusimu bimawaqi'in nujum, which means I do swear to the setting sites of the stars, which you see happening on every night and setting by the approach of the dawn every morning. The word farawhun, arrawh here is different than arruh. Arrawh means a state of rest, comfort, and relief. Arrayhan, it refers to the delight and the infinite joy.
To please Allah, a chance to gain reward, I will spend on you, he said.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Welcome back. A time to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is your host Gabriel Al-Romaani, and I'm joined by Brother Asif. Alhamdulillah, he was my co-host. Inshallah, will be joining us much more often from now. Alhamdulillah, jazakallah khair. And Brother Ayat will also be joining us much more often, inshallah,
bi-idhnillah.
Alhamdulillah, you know, this program has been just amazing. We're over 1 year now, alhamdulillah. And, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah, but we're getting a lot of good feedback, alhamdulillah. And this is the most important thing, is that there's benefit.
As long as people benefiting this,
we're serving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through benefiting Allah the people. We're in the khidmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by serving helping out people. Alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us be like the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. We want to be like them.
This is the point, obviously. We're not talking about the Sahaba as an academic exercise.
No. Right?
The idea is that we should respect them, we should love them, but the most important thing, as is the case with the Sunnah and the Prophet ﷺ, is that we should emulate them, right? So when Allah said, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمْ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرُ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. So the thing is, you know, when we're talking about loving Allah, this is specifically talking about loving Allah. This is something that basically all of humanity claims.
No, sahih.
Muslim, anyway. Non-Muslim, anybody. They say we love God. We love, you know, of course. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very clearly and specifically giving you the equation. Mm. That if you love Allah, then it will be proven in your actions.
Yeah.
Right? So going back to my point, the love of the Sahaba has manifestations. Right? We must emulate them. We must be like them. We must at least try to be like them, even though we cannot achieve the heights that they achieved. So subhanAllah, out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the merciful nature of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there's a hadith from Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was once at a graveyard, right? And he was thinking, he was contemplating, and he said, I wish I could live long enough to see my brothers. My ikhwan, he used the word ikhwan. So the Sahaba were amazed at this and said, Ya Rasulullah, aren't we your ikhwan? He says, no, you are my Sahaba, you are my companions. My ikhwan are those people who will believe in me, who will come after me and believe in me without having seen me.
Allahu Akbar.
So this is an opportunity. This is a goal. It's an opportunity coming to us on a silver platter.
To be called the brothers of.
To be called the brothers of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the ikhwan of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? And the way, the equation once again is to follow his way, right? When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when people are wanting for on Yom Al Qiyamah for the Day of Judgment to start, right? They will go from prophet to prophet, and each one will say, Nafsi, Nafsi. He is the only one who will say, Ummati, Ummati.
Allah. Yeah, Allah.
This is the concern that he had of going back to the point of why did the Sahaba love him so much? Yeah. Why was it love? Because they believed this, all of these things that are the foundations of our aqidah. What will happen in Yawm al-Qiyamah? The role of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is the one that will beseech Allah to start even the Day of Judgment. He is the one who will intercede for us. So many things, so many benefits that are coming through his hands from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And just to say, you know, like, any, they loved him because he also loved them so much, subhanAllah.
And the yaqeen they had, the certainty they had in Islam and in believing the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Over here nowadays, we say we're following the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we compromise. We compromise, like someone said, like how, I think you mentioned in the beginning, someone said, astaghfirullah al-azim, if, because they are actually, they having the deen in their lap according to nowadays world. Some people would say like if the Prophet Muhammad would be here, he would shave off his beard. So we have now this kind of people nowadays. Yeah. Muslim gonna say those kind of words.
Yes.
But no. Those Sahaba, they underwent torture. They were being executed, they were being kicked out from the hometown and they went for jihad just in order to keep that deen on the plate, like how he said. We're just here to read and apply into our life.
Yeah. So easy.
It's just easy. But we don't do it.
We
just don't do it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those people who follow the Prophet Muhammad and those people who came after him, which is, who are the Sahaba. If we were to look at it, not only the men love the Sahaba, even the women love the Sahaba. Umara, we don't want to start this story now because we don't have much time.
We will have the next episode, inshallah.
We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among
the female companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and their status in Islam, inshallah. Because it says this, I don't want to mix it because this requires a full episode, you know, for us to speak about the Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, the Sahabiyat, and Sumayya, and you know, and some of the
Salim,
subhanAllah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yani help us to, inshallah, to reach the next episode, and to may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us yani even. If we would be half of the Sahaba, yani.
No. Aim high.
Yes, that's true. Yeah, aim high, yani, subhanAllah. Yeah. But yani, I'm just saying, if we would just be half of them, yani, we would yani the world would be different, yani. You know.
We have to try. Yes. At least step. The journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. Yeah, at least get out on the journey to try it and make that your intention. Oh. And the success will come.
And that requires a paradigm shift.
It is very true.
Allah people says, are kneeling to, yeah, need to take.
وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Let's try.
Allah.
وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ.
جزاكم الله خيرا for another beautiful episode, mashallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and bless all the viewers.
Ameen.
Please don't forget to check the Facebook page. Spread, inshallah, share. An episode like this, yani, deserves to be shared. Alhamdulillah, for people to learn. جزاكم الله خيرا سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
السلام
ورحمة الله
Please Allah, a chance to gain reward, I will spend on you, he says, on who spend in good cause.
Good deeds are opportunities, sparkling bright and true, raising you in the sight of Allah, and adorning Al-Jannah for you. So rush to earn his reward, don't forget the